This is Dan the Beast Severn, the only Triple Crown champion from the UFC's No Holds Barred era. And you're listening to Martial Arts World Radio with Joseph Clark. You had better listen, otherwise, I know where you live.
Welcome to Martial Arts World Radio. I'm your host, Joseph Clark. Each and every episode, we speak to the biggest names in martial arts and combat sports, from the UFC, Bellator, and the Olympics, as well as martial arts legends, pioneers, and cinema stars. We discuss best practices, perspectives, and philosophies, using martial arts as a metaphor for the peaks and valleys of life's journey. Over the next hour, I will be featuring my interviews with UFC Hall of Famer and Superfight champion Dan Severn, dedicated martial artist and star of the KickBoxer sequels, SASHA MITCHELL, inductee of four different International Martial Arts Hall of Fames, world bareknuckle full contact champion and co-star of the action film Avenging Force, Gary Alexander, and accomplished martial artist, actor, celebrity bodyguard, and stuntman, Chuck Zito. Our quote of the week is brought to you by www.bobwall.net, the official fan homepage of martial arts legend Bob Wall. This week's inspirational quote is from the movie Kill Bill and goes as follows. Revenge is never a straight line. It is a forest, and like a forest, it is easy to lose your way, to get lost, to forget where you came from. Sonny Chiba as Hattori Hanzo in the film Kill Bill. Now, please note that all four of today's interviews were conducted remotely at the Action Martial Arts Hall of Honors Expo. Please excuse the background noise as these interviews were recorded in a crowded, open conference center, and it was quite loud. Our interview with Gary Alexander is brought to you by the books The Tao of MMA and 21st Century Perspectives on Martial Arts. Both books are available at Amazon by searching them by their titles, The Tao, T-A-O, of MMA, and 21st Century Perspectives on Martial Arts. Gary Alexander is an American martial artist, karate fighter, author, and actor. He was Black Belt Magazine's co-instructor of the year in 1974, and is known as the first international bare-knuckle contact karate champion. On November 17, 1962, Gary Alexander won the first Canadian karate championship sponsored by Master Soroka. On November 24th of 1962, Alexander won the North American Championship, sponsored by Mas Oyama, which was held at Madison Square Garden. Both events were bare-knuckle full contact. The winner was the last man standing. Alexander is a member of the Black Belt Magazine's Hall of Fame, Action Martial Arts Hall of Fame, World Karate Union Hall of Fame, and the Australasian Martial Arts Hall of Fame. Gary is a Marine veteran who served in the Pacific with Weapons Company 1st Battalion Fighting 9th Marines, Fleet Marine Force, and has acted in films and on television, specifically Gideon Oliver with Lou Gossett Jr. for Universal Pictures and Avenging Force with Michael Dudikoff for Canon Pictures. He is also the producer and star of a series of 20 martial arts instructional videos and is also the author of Unarmed and Dangerous, Hand-to-Hand Combat, and Defense Systems.
Grandmaster Gary Alexander, welcome to Martial Arts World Radio.
Joseph, thanks very much for inviting me.
Gary, were you really the world's first bare-knuckle champion fighter?
Yeah, you want to look at the knuckles? Nobody's going to admit that. I just wrote my autobiography, Trailblazer 1. I'm trying to have a movie made out of it, and yes, I was. Just came out of the Marine Corps, trained up. First event was Masuyama in Madison Square Garden, and Soroka had his in Canada the week before. Went up there, won up there, came back down here to Madison Square Garden, won there, and there we go. So.
And you did some film work. I know you worked with Michael Dudikoff. You were in, for example, the movie Avenging Force. You were in some other films. Would you tell us a little bit about when Hollywood came calling you as a martial artist?
Well, I'll give you some original stuff. I had a shot at 007 when I was fighting. I was the only champion. At 65, you had a group of guys that come up, okay? And they all piled around. I was alone. I still am. But anyway, back when I was fighting, I had an interview with United Artists. And just out of the Marine Corps, a fighter, and I had family obligations. They said, go home, take pictures, come back in. Pictures in a bathing suit, pictures lifting weights. I figured, this is queer. I'm a fighter. I don't do this. I never went back. But that took care of that. But with Dudikoff, that was Avenging Force. That was with Canon Films. And I've done a lot of work walking around Hollywood looking for work. And one day they gave me a shot with him. I had some fun with that. And then Lou Gossett Jr., I did a show with him. It was made for TV called Gideon Oliver. I trained as a stunt fighter. I did some casting for them. I actually did the role of fighting in the ring for him, like that. He's a great guy, and had a lot of fun with that, too. I did a film up in Las Vegas, the mountains, for Special Forces, showing... showing some of the troops up there how to handle the fighting in that environment. Not that I needed to, but they wanted me to do that. And they're great people. And they went up there, and I had to make it look so that they didn't look bad, and I didn't look bad. And that's 8,000 feet up in the air. I just did one last year called Awakened out in Southampton, Long Island. And I was out there as their bodyguard. I did a cameo appearance and whatever. At this point in time, if they want to see me in the movies, they got to stuff me and put me on stage. But I am trying to get a film company to make my film. I just wrote my autobiography and memoirs called Trailblazer 1. Okay? And it goes back. It's all about me. That's what it's about. Okay? But it goes back and covers everything that happened in the martial arts for the last 50, 60 years. Since I'm only 21. That's it. But I am looking for investors. I'm looking for film companies. And that's my big quest right now.
Gary, we really look forward to seeing the movie when it comes out. I'm sure it'll be a success. And I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with us today.
Thank you very much. You'll probably have Bugs Bunny do my part.
All the best.
Joseph.
Likewise.
Good luck.
This has been my interview with Grandmaster Gary Alexander.
This is Olivier Gruner. You are listening to Martial Arts World Radio with Joseph Clark.
Our interview with Sasha Mitchell is brought to you by our web marketing affiliates, Everlast, Century Martial Arts, MMA Warehouse, and UFC Store. Check them out at our website at www.mawradio.com. Sasha Mitchell is a dedicated Taekwondo and Muay Thai practitioner. He is the star of several films and is noted for taking over the lead role from Jean-Claude Van Damme in KickBoxer 2, 3, and 4.
Sasha Mitchell, welcome to Martial Arts World Radio. Thanks for speaking with us.
Oh, thank you. It's great to be here. I love this martial arts convention we do every year in Atlantic City.
We love you, Sasha! We love you!
At what age did you begin Taekwondo?
You know, when I was a kid in high school, we trained in military school and then in the PAL, boxing. And I must have started like, 12 years old. Yeah.
That's a good age.
I started training with Benny Akitas. I was 18 years old, Sensei Ben. So that was at the old Jet Center, the original one on Friar Street. Trained there forever. Then I brought my children over to the other Jet Center that was by Gold's Gym on Laurel, and they trained there with Sensei Majid and Sensei Ben, everybody. The Jet Center is really where I got, you know, my foundation. I did that kickboxing movie, Kickboxer 2, with him, and, you know, I trained primarily with him. And he put me with another trainer for a little while, Shuki Ron, and he learned from Majiro Gym style, the guys in Holland, Thai boxers in Holland, because they're a little bit taller, a little bit longer legs, and so it's kind of a different hip movement, kind of a little bit better for me. But Sensei Benny's always been my sensei.
You're a pretty big guy yourself, so do you tend to work on your speed or your flexibility, or are there certain aspects that when you're training that you try to emphasize?
Speed, because I am big and heavy. And I always liked working on speed better because, you know, like my son was unbelievable and athletic. When he was like 2 years old, he would walk around our dinner table and climb up the back of my chair and stand on my shoulders while I was eating. And he's just that way. He was a year and a half, he would climb up fences and climb down fences. But for me, it was always like I had to work on everything I did really hard. So speed and coordination really was mine. Power I had, you know, but when I was really young, I worked out every day. I still work out every single day, like a couple hours a day in the gym. But, you know, my body was always light. I was always like around 190, you know, couldn't get any bigger. And then as I got older, my body kind of slowed down. My metabolism slowed down, and I put on some size, a little bit bigger. So, but I'm still always working on speed.
And did you start adding other martial arts or other systems to your repertoire?
Really, just Aikido Kan, that's Benny Akitas style, and then the Majiro Gym style from Thailand. Like, you can see the difference in my styles, like, from one, like, Kickboxer 2 to Kickboxer 3 was more Thai style.
And do you train your ground game at all?
You know, I trained with Yakov Bresler, and he's more Krav Maga, so we train there. But it looks good, you know, when he starts throwing me around, it looks good in the dojo, you know. So we do that. I love Yakov. He's a great guy. And he's been out of the Jet Center for like 25 years. Yeah, he's a really good guy.
Sasha, you had some interesting opportunities as an actor. I believe you started fairly young as well as an actor. Can you tell us about how you were discovered, or did you approach Hollywood?
I was born in L.A., raised there, UCLA. And but no, I was in military school in New York, and I knew a guy that was a photographer, like an Italian guy from Italy. You know, he's like, look, you know, if I take a picture of you and I show it to these agents, you know, if just let me take one picture and give me $100, I'll split it with you. You know, and I was like, no, man, you know, he's like, look, you can make some money. So he took a picture of me, he showed it to an agent, and that guy, that one agent really just started me doing everything. He's like, go over here and talk to these guys. And so I did my first TV show, like, in Spanish. I mean, it was American TV, but I spoke Spanish in it. It was like a love story with Ricky Nelson's daughter, Tracy. It was like an ABC movie of the week. I got a couple Clio Awards doing commercials. It was like one of those, is it Love or is it Memorex? And there was like, there was a whole bunch of commercials I did. And then I started doing TV, and then I got TV shows and movies. It all came about differently, but I was born here, so my family was, like, from the clothing business, and they weren't really thinking about acting or movies. It took me a long time to even tell my father I was doing movies or acting. Yeah. Forget about it.
And then, of course, you're known very well for your role on Dallas as well. Tell us about that experience.
Oh, that was amazing. They were so sweet, really kind people. Larry Hagman was a wonderful guy to work with, and Patrick Duffy, of course. Yeah, I did two shows with him where I played his nephew on Dallas and on Step by Step. So I loved working with Patrick. I loved working with Larry. And Leonard Katzman, the producer, he was a really sweet guy. Really nice people. It's kind of hard, though, because on a drama, you know, there's not really, like, as good of a rhythm as there is with comedy or action. You know, like, we always got a punchline. So in, like, an action movie, there's, like, a certain amount of dialogue before you take a punch. And the same thing with a comedy, you know, it's like, you got a little bit of dialogue, there's a punchline and a joke. But with, I remember Dallas was being like, you know, you say a lot, you talk a lot, but you don't really go anywhere, you know. Yeah, it was funny. But it was a great show.
And then Kickboxer, would you tell us, was there any kind of story or anecdote around the casting of how you got into Kickboxer too? Because, I mean, that was a sequel to the Van Damme film. Great opportunity.
That was really just a vision from Albert Pune. He came to Sensei Benny, Benny Akitas, and he said, you know, I need one of your fighters, and I think Sasha could do it. And it was really Albert Pune. It was his idea, and that was it. I don't know what he saw. Maybe he saw Spike and Bensonhurst. You know, in Spike we were fighting and boxing, and that was a comedy. So maybe he liked the... I think that was it. I know the vision was Albert. He just decided that's what I was going to do it.
Did you actually have to read for it, or did he just basically recruit you out of the gym with the endorsement of Benny the Jet?
I think it was just through Sensei Ben. Yeah, I think Benny, it was his recommendation, and I think he went and looked at some of the stuff that I had done so he knew I could act, and I think really that was it. I don't think, maybe I went and read to meet with them and talk with them. No, he came over to my house and I was working on my trees. I was doing bonsai in the backyard. And he was, I was like, oh, you go inside and sit down and talk formally, because he came over to talk to me. And I was doing the trees. You know, my father was like the first Caucasian NAMP guy in America, and the Grandmaster of bonsai. And he's got trees like in the National Arboretum in D.C. and in... you know, the Descanso Gardens in California, and our teacher, the National Arboretum in D.C. is named after John Naka, our teacher. And outside the garden, outside is George Yamaguchi's garden. And so I learned from them. I was in Nampukai also, but I was maybe like ninth. You know, he was the first Caucasian, so it was really a big deal. And so when Albert came over to my house, I was in the backyard working on my trees. We spent like maybe 5-6 hours, and I was just wiring and trimming, and then we went over to see Sensei Ben. I think I didn't go in and read. Yeah, but it was like that.
Do you have some favorite martial artists of your own?
Well, Sensei Benny, yeah, Don Wilson. Have you followed Don Wilson? Not just his amazing acting career, but his fighting career. Maurice Smith, I mean, the guy's beat everyone. Yeah. Of course, Petey Cunningham, Bill Wallace, one of my favorite guys in the whole world, Ernesto Oost, you know, like, oh, man, yeah, those, of course, I'm a martial arts fan. I've got guys I love. Yeah, do you remember, like, Stan the Man Longanides? Amazing guy. Yeah, he trained with Shuki. Peter Cunningham, one of my best guys, though. I love him. Yeah. Remember Alex Garcia? Well, boxers, you know, yeah, Hector Pena, Hector Lopez. Hector Lopez, amazing boxer. He used to tune up Sensei Ben for his fights. You know, I mean, for different reasons, you like martial artists for some of the different things that they do, but yeah.
And then, Sasha, between Kickboxer 2 and 3, do you have a personal favorite or a preference between the two?
They're so different. No, I love them both. Of course, there was so much blood in Kickboxer 2. I like a lot less blood. You know that? And that was pretty bloody and gory and stuff, and you know, so, but I love Kickboxer 2. I was lucky enough to be able to work with Sensei Benny, you know, doing the coordinating, and I worked with him every day. Can you imagine? Like 3 hours a day every day, just me. And then the other cast members that we had got to work with us at the Jet Center, and that was just like, can you imagine getting paid for staying home at your dojo every day with your sensei. You know, it was like, that was amazing. KickBoxer 3 was a lot of fun. We went to Brazil with my daughters, and I remember my oldest daughter, Pavlina, I got to teach her how to swim in Brazil because they had all these, a million different pools of different varying depths. So I had a really good time in Brazil. And a lot of the fighting and coordinating we did. In KickBoxer 4, you know, we had the Machado brothers. And so that was amazing. You know, Egan Machado and John Machado came, and we got to do the coordinating together with them, and I love those guys. So for every different reason, you know, every little job, there's always beautiful parts to it you love. Yeah.
So, Sasha, our closing question, and I really appreciate your time today. You know, looking at the KickBoxer movies, perhaps if you throw them on with your kids from time to time and you see that young Sasha Mitchell who's in those movies, if you could go back in time and give him some advice, what would it be?
I don't know. I don't know that I would have done anything really differently. You know, I spent the last, like, 21 years raising my kids alone, 28 years I've had children, and I think really the one thing in my entire life I'm most proud of is just my babies. And that, you know, they were raised by me, and I put in all the time I could, and that now the kind of people they are is that they love other people. You know, that's what I always told them. Well, look, we're people. There are certain kind of people out there, there are things people. And of course we have things and we need things, but you know, we love people, number one, and they're all in different industries where they take care of, you know, like children or, you know, autistic kids. My oldest daughter goes to school with to teach them, you know, how to fit into their school systems. And, you know, I'm just so proud of them. I don't know if I would have done anything different ever in my life. And I was kind of set in my ways even at young, but probably if I was fortunate enough, I would have stayed in school forever. You know, I always thought if I was like a super rich guy, all I would do is go to school. First, learn how to be a doctor, learn how to be a lawyer, learn how to be a physicist, engineer. Only just because I love school.
Sasha, thanks again for taking the time. And congratulations on your career. All the best.
Thank you. I was very fortunate.
You have been listening to my interview with martial artist and cinema star, Sasha Mitchell. Be sure to check us out at www.mawradio.com and click on the Martial Arts World Radio Store, where you will find our t-shirt and hoodie with the Bruce Lee quote from Enter the Dragon, "Bored, not hit back." Both the shirt and hoodie are black with the Martial Arts World Radio logo in red on the sleeve and the back of the shirt. They can be purchased securely directly from our site. Chuck Zito is an accomplished martial artist, actor, celebrity bodyguard, and stuntman. He is the former president of the New York chapter of the Hell's Angels and has competed as an amateur boxer. Chuck is also known for downing action star Jean-Claude Van Damme with a two-punch combo during an altercation in an East Side New York topless bar. Chuck authored his autobiography, Street Justice, which was a huge hit, and he has also been a radio personality with the recurring Chuck Zito's View on Howard Stern's Sirius satellite radio channels.
Chuck Zito, welcome to Martial Arts World Radio.
Hey, thanks for having me, man.
We appreciate your time today. Would you please tell us about training with Henzo Gracie?
Well, Henzo's one of the best, man. He's great. Gracie Jiu-Jitsu is no better, man.
And as I understand it, you also trained with Bob Wall.
I've trained Bob Wall, Chuck Norris, Bill Silver Wallace, a lot of guys.
You like the diversity of mixed martial arts?
You know what, I've been boxing since I was 5 years old. I had my first ring fight at 12 because my father was a professional boxer, so I started boxing first. Then, of course, after seeing Bruce Lee and the Green Hornet, I wanted to become a martial artist. And I enrolled in Aaron Banks' karate dojo in New York City and started taking white crane and tiger claw kung fu. And then I went out to Ishido Karate, Chikiri Jiu-Jitsu, Kumite Ryu Jiu-Jitsu, VRNS Jiu-Jitsu, and I trained with Enzo Gracie in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. You know, I've trained 8 different styles of martial arts, so I mix everything together. You know, so it's my own system, which is a street survival system.
Yeah, Bob Wall recommended I asked you about your father, who was a professional boxer. Could you tell us a few things about him?
Yeah, my father was a professional boxer in the 30s and the 40s. He was a welterweight, lightweight welterweight back in the day. His name was Al LaBarbera. And his cousin was a flyweight champion of the world, Fidel LaBarbera. And my father fought for 13 years, had 228 fights in that time. So he's a great fighter. He was supposed to fight Marty Servo for the welterweight championship, and then he got drafted in World War II. Went to war for 3 years and came out, and a few more fights, and then retired.
Distinguished career and a lot of life experience there.
Yes, yes. So I learned from him, and he taught me how to box at an early age. And I've been doing martial arts for over 40 years now, so.
So, Chuck, based on your experience, between what you see happening in the octagon, in the cage, in the dojo, what would really work well in the street?
Well, I always try to do a traditional jiu-jitsu, not the grappling, because a lot of thing locks his eye pokes, his elbows, everything. It's but of course, training with Henzo now, when he grabs somebody, that's when you take him down. So it's awesome. I mean, you just combine everything, and that's what I've done all through the years, the last 40 years, combine all my eight styles together.
Do you have a favorite martial artist or fighter who you looked upon as an inspiration?
I mean, well, come on, back, of course, Bruce Lee. Yeah, he was the Muhammad Ali of the martial arts back then. And, of course, you know, guys like Bill Silver Wallace and Bob Wall and Chuck Norris. And you grew up with guys, these guys. And, of course, later on, Don Dragon Wilson and, you know, guys. And, of course, now, starting in 1993, the mixed martial arts, the MMA and the UFC. So there's a lot of great fighters. A lot of great fighters out there that I look up to.
Is there a particular fighter in the UFC that you favor over others?
You know what? There's a lot of dear friends of mine, but Randy Couture was a great fighter. He was six times, you know, UFC champion. You got to give him credit for that, man. And there's great guys. I mean, you know, Chuck Liddell and Matt Hughes and, you know, guys like that. And, you know, George St. Pierre. And now who's the badass now is Conor McGregor, man, you know. So he's up and coming guy.
So you did follow George St. Pierre's career?
Oh, absolutely. I followed everybody's career. I was at UFC, you know, UFC 1, Denver, Colorado, 1993. You know, Bill Silver Wallace was the commentator, along with Kathy Long and Jim Brown. So I've been following from day one. And I try to go to a lot of them, you know, if I'm around in town. I've been going to a lot of them. Last week I went to Bellator fight with Ortiz, you know, Tito Ortiz and Charles Sonnen. So I was over there. And it was great because there was so many. There had to be 25 fighters in the audience. There were 25 fighters, starting from the Don Fry to Hoyce Gracie, who started it all.
Yes, that's great.
Yeah, Hoyce Gracie, he's the godfather of the octagon, man. Yeah, they started it.
I noticed that you still get asked to do a lot of interviews for your opinion on the UFC. Still getting a lot of calls?
Sure. I do a lot of things. And like I said, I try and go to most of the fights. And whether it's UFC or, you know, any mixed martial arts or boxing, I try to attend a bunch of them. So.
A wrap-up question for you, and I appreciate your time, Chuck. Looking over your repertoire of your films, all the movies that you've done, do you have a favorite production that you're involved in?
You know what, I always, my first TV series was Oz, you know, the HBO series Oz. I was on it for 5 years, and that was always a great experience. My most recent series was Sons of Anarchy. I did a big movie with Jason Statham a couple of years ago called Homefront. And I'm going to start one myself soon that I wrote, that I'm producing, starring, and directing, called Street Justice. And we're going to start that in June in New York.
Are you an author as well?
Yes, I wrote my own book. Of course, it was called Street Justice also. I wrote my book, and I do author. I was host on Howard Stern's 101 for 6 years. So I do a lot of things. I have a lot of hats.
You wear a lot of hats. Chuck, do you have a website that we can direct our listeners to if they're interested in checking you out?
Yeah, ChuckZito.com. I mean, I'm totally off social media now for the last couple of years. So I'm not on Facebook or any of that stuff, but I still have a website.
Very good. Actually, I lied. I have one more question, Chuck. Any charitable endeavors or avocations or causes that you like to support?
I support them all, man. I always do a lot of things. My niece had, you know, brain cancer when she was 7 years old, so I do the St. Jude's a lot. But I do the Wounded Warriors, everybody. Anybody that came home who was offended our country, I always go to their things when I can. So things like that I do, I attend.
Chuck, thank you so much for joining me today and for talking to us here at Alan Goldberg's Expo.
Hey, thank you for asking.
You have been listening to my interview with Chuck Zito.
This is UFC fighter Jason Sago. You are now listening to Martial Arts World Radio with Joseph Clark.
Please note that all four of today's interviews were conducted remotely at the Action Martial Arts Hall of Honors Expo, so please excuse the background noise as these interviews were recorded in a very crowded and loud open conference center. Our interview with Dan Severn is brought to you by the books The Tao of MMA and 21st Century Perspectives on Martial Arts. Both books are available at Amazon by searching them by their title, The Tao, T-A-O of MMA, and 21st Century Perspectives on Martial Arts. Dan the Beast Severn is a UFC Hall of Fame inductee, UFC Superfight champion, and he is the only UFC Triple Crown champion. A pioneer of MMA, he went on to a successful career in combat sports and wrestling entertainment. And yes, he has both a UFC and old WWF action figure.
Dan Severn, welcome to Martial Arts World Radio. Thanks for your time today.
Joseph, it's great to be here.
Dan, the ultimate destination for MMA and Martial Arts Mega Expo. How many years have you attended this?
I'm trying to think how many years has it been running. I'd say it's got to been running for about 20 or more years. I'd say that I've been here at least 50% of the time.
Good stuff. And, of course, Alan Goldberg has done something here that's very unique. It almost feels like, as I was saying to Sasha Mitchell, like a high school reunion when everybody gets together here.
No, yeah, you see a lot of the same people from year to year. When you look at the instructors or the, I'll say the guest attractions, the various standout martial artists that may have gone in and been a part of different types of movies or maybe in the Guinness Book of World Records for breaking boards or whatever. So it is kind of like the who's who of the martial arts world.
Now, the UFC, WWF, all of your journeys and travels, I mean, it's been a roller coaster ride, no doubt. Early days of the UFC, is there something momentous or unique that you might share with me, an experience that stands out?
Well, I would say that to all of your listeners, because we are a very forgetful society anymore, the product that they watch currently, known as MMA, which stands for Mixed Martial Arts, has only been around since probably the mid-2000s, around that 2004-2005, did actually be coined that phrase. The predecessor that started back in the 1994 time frame was known as NHB, which stood for No Holds Barred. The vast difference between those two eras of the Ultimate Fighting Championships companies is during the mixed martial arts era, there are approximately 47 to 49 rules now, whereas back in that No Holds Barred era, there were only two rules, that being do not bite your opponent. Rule number two, no sticking fingers in the eye socket, known as eye gouging. End of the rules, no weight classes, no time periods, bare-knuckled action, and you had the eight-man tournament where the same two-hour pay-per-view that still runs to this day where people face one opponent. Back then in the No Holds Barred era, you had to face and defeat three opponents. And I am the only Triple Crown champion from the UFC's No Holds Barred era. And since it's illegal to do, I'm in.
So when we look at that belt over there from the original UFC, I mean, I can only imagine the emotion and the pride that you feel when you take a look at that and you see how MMA has evolved today.
You know, the two belts I have represented, one's from the Wacky World of Professional Wrestling, the other one is from the real world of cage fighting. Again, I use it as a broad term because it encompasses both the No Holds Barred era and the mixed martial arts era. Yeah, that there's only two belts on display right there, but I actually have two more belts that are laying in the bags right there. Just not enough room on the table to display the actions. Yes, a great deal of pride is involved in that, but also to be one of the pioneers of that industry and to see it through from its nose bar, dark ages, as referred to the more modern mixed martial arts version that you have today, and to see the popularity grow in the vastness that it has.
Dan, the early days of the UFC, did you have any idea at that time or suspect it was going to grow into what it was today?
Yes, because of an experiment I did with just a couple of my buddies that were mad dashing. They were going to stop by my place just to drop off a couple things
crashed because they had to hurriedly go out the next day. So knowing that I saw them something pull into my driveway, I popped in the UFC VHS tape. And as they come in, I had the volume up extra loud. I was sitting on the couch, and I actually made them come on over because I was like, I was pretending to really be engrossed into watching it. And they're like, well, what's this? I go, wow, I said, this is crazy cage fight. That's something I'm toying with the idea of getting involved with. And they're watching this. Well, let's put it this way. They're hurting us an hour and a half later. As I'm watching these two guys screaming and yelling, twisting and contorting on my couch here with me, I'm thinking, there's something here. There's distraction. But then I always know that people, for some reason, people are drawn to violence, violent acts of the nature they make with their hand or their face, but they all want to sneak that peek in the process. So there is the attraction there on a multiple of different levels.
Dan, in terms of combat sports, at what age did you actually start taking some kind of professional instruction?
I took a judo class as a freshman in college. I was a very high-level amateur wrestler. I was looking to do anything that would enhance my wrestling ability. Like, for example, I took a nutrition class, so I knew that everything I ate and put in my body was going to make me the ultimate wrestler. So that I took a weightlifting class so I could actually, even though it was all geared towards football and basketball and all that stuff, I was able to take that same knowledge and create the same type of weightlifting type programs for an amateur wrestler. And then by taking that judo class, you know, I had two instructors. I had an Asian instructor and I had an American instructor. The Asian instructor hated me because I did not conform totally to the judokian way. Now, the American instructor, I basically talked to both of them, and I told him why I took the class, was to add to my amateur wrestling, but also I was fulfilling all of their obligations. But when I stepped on the mat and they would be trying to show all these traditional type of techniques, when it came to live sparring, I was that guy that was already migrating my freestyle wrestling, my Greco-Roman wrestling, my folk style wrestling into this form of judo, and I'm mauling everybody in the class. And the Asian instructor did not like it. Well, the American instructor, he thought it was pretty unique. He came and actually watched some of the home dual meets when I was actually representing Arizona State University, and he actually saw how I was using foot sweeps and things of nature. I was using my legs like an extra pair of arms. At the end of the season, he goes, well, Dan, now that your season's over, would you like to go and see one of these judo tournaments? And I go, well, sure. And I travel with this ASU squad down to, I don't know, I think it was Tucson, Arizona. And when we got there, he goes, well, now that you're here, would you like to actually compete in this? And I go, well, I probably would, but I don't have a judo gi yet. Ta-da, he had all, it was a setup. And again, it's just my way of making a long story short that I walked out there as just a wrestler, mauling people, learning more and more technique on the way. So what's my true profession? I jumped in the Ultimate Fighting Championships after having a 5-day training camp of an hour and a half a day. I never trained a single strike. I never trained a single legitimate submission. When I was asked, when I arrived there, what is your martial art? I said, I've never been asked that question. I just said, looked at him and go, I'm an American wrestler. They had never heard that reply before. And they're like, well, what exactly does that do? And I look right back at them in the face and go, I'm not sure. I'm making this up as I go. Just watch my match. And literally, I was flying by the seat of my pants.
Well, you were breaking tradition and applying what was relative to you and what was practical, and it worked. Proof's in the pudding.
Now, the other aspect I'll say is that when I looked at this, I'm a very calculated type person. I would never pursue, say, a kickboxing match because those are not the skills that I possess. But I kept thinking, when I saw this skinny little guy doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, I go, well, of course, I'm talking about Hoist Gracie. I go, well, kind of looks like wrestling in pajamas to me. I go, I figure that if a guy's got to be within arm's distance to punch me, he's got to be within legs distance to kick me, I'll simply span a range. And that, what they're taught is they throw out and recoil their hands and legs back. When they recoil back, I will simply slide right up to them, and I will clinch them, and I will go, welcome to my world, and you will never see the light of day again. And unless I decide to cut you loose, because I know the reward of being released to you is you're going to kick me, punch me, elbow me, or whatever, and I go, I don't like to be hit. So my wrestling skills saw me through very, very well.
Did you surprise yourself in the UFC?
No. I'm not saying that to be over-embellished, but it's, I knew that if I stay to what my strengths were and try not to be something I was not, I will do just fine, because I was already a very high caliber wrestler, and it would take a pretty unique high caliber person that's going to end up beating me. But if I don't dance your game, no, I'm a tough cat to beat.
How did you relate to Royce Gracie?
I can't relate to him at all. I mean, he's from Brazil, even though he lives in the States. You know, I'll just simply say that Christmas came early. What I should have did to him 20-some years ago, I didn't. I would still heavily consider coming back out of retirement for one of only a couple people, other people from my vintage. To go against Young Bucks, no. Hard to say for any professional athlete is to know when it's time to move along. And a lot of them stay in too long, and they are wrecked into retirement, and now they may have physical problems to go along with them instead of having whatever quality of life. Now they're going to have a diminished quality of life.
In terms of the UFC today and Bellator and other fight promotion companies, are you surprised at how they've grown and how they've evolved, or do you think that this was something that was overdue?
No, I'll say that I'm surprised that it grew as quickly, because when you think about a sport in a 20-year span, what has done, no other sport has done this. And to rival sports that have been around for 100-plus years, of, you know, when you look at the numbers that football has done, the numbers that basketball, baseball, the UFC has rivaled those same numbers, and just to be sure, attendance-wise, for live events, or even in the pay-per-views. So that has done something very incredible, but then also the fact that you can speak to the pioneers of the sport because they're still alive. A Royce Gracie is still alive. A Ken Shamrock is still alive. A Dan Severn is still alive.
And then the transition to wrestling.
Are we talking wrestling, or are we talking professional wrestling?
Wrestling, WWF, obviously an opportunity to do some entertainment, an interesting gig. How did that come around?
Well, I give you some timetables here. I have been an amateur wrestler since 1969. I've been a professional wrestler since the 1992 Olympics, and a cage fighter since 1994, so give you some time frames. So I was a professional wrestler first, not the cage fighter, but when people saw me go from the UFC and then into WWF, they kept thinking, you're a sellout. I go, really? I go, if you really want to know the truth, the people of professional wrestling ought to be mad, because I was their first profession and I sold out to be a cage fighter. But they're like, oh, but that's okay. Ah, a little catch-22 here right now. So being involved in professional wrestling is something that I thought about early in life. I actually had several promotions contact me to be involved with this, but had I turned pro at that time, I would have lost my amateur competition status, and my amateur wrestling career meant too much to me. So I turned them down, but as of the 1992 Olympics, a new rule came into place that allowed me to be both amateur and professional simultaneously. So I could still make an Olympic team if I wanted to, but I could be a professional wrestler.
And then a wrap-up question. People in your life who are an inspiration to you, who motivated you, people that you looked up to?
I'll just say very few people that will ever fall into that type of category. You know, I do a lot of the things I do. I'll say it's in honor of my own parents, for the upbringing and the work ethic that they instilled into me. I think that's probably the best credit I will give is I pay homage to them, because they're both gone, and I'm the perfect blend of both of my parents. My father was a quiet man, but a very powerful man, and a man of few words, but by God, those words meant something. So I definitely carry that same tradition, and my mother was that risk-taker, fly-by-the-seat-of-your-pants, so I am definitely that blend of both of my parents. So I do that for their honor.
Dan, do you do keynotes, appearances, or seminars?
Well, Joseph, I do a ton of different things. I'm a man of many trades. I teach in the sport of amateur wrestling. Of course, that goes without saying, that's my first love. but then I teach other forms of amateur wrestling, such as freestyle wrestling, Greco-Roman wrestling. These are what we do on the international scene, Olympic Games, World Championships. But then also since 1994, I've been working with law enforcement. I do especially ground defensive tactics programs, but law enforcement, corrections, air marshals, border patrol, military, and what I was told was I'm still the very first civilian ever to be brought on base for the world's largest private security company by the name of VXL out of Montrose, Virginia. It's my knowledge of physical mechanics. I've been brought in, well, even just less than a year ago, I was brought into the Sheriff's Department. And the first they asked me, the gentleman, I've done several of my ground defensive tactics programs before, he goes, he loves the simplicity how I teach. And he goes, my guys get it from you way faster than anybody else. And so as he keeps bringing me back in, he calls me up once out of the blue. He says, what do you know about cell extractions? And I go, I kid, they say, well, you know, I've watched Lockdown a few times on TV. He laughs. He goes, it doesn't quite happen like that. And he just told me, says, bring me in. Let me see what you guys are doing already. Whether it's, you know, and he goes, there's two-man teams, three-man teams, four-man teams that go into a cell. I go, let me be all parts. Let me be part of the team. So they watch it first. Let me be part of the team. But then let me be the bad guy to feel what this all feel like. And what, without a hesitation, I went right from there, seeing what they're doing, and I made it easier yet. And he just shakes his head. He goes, I don't know how you do it, but he goes, these are simple things that are easy for us now to teach others. So I take a great deal of pride in what I teach there because I know that what I teach, it's going to save lives. As for life and death, because I always say that I have never done any of the above. I'm from the world of competition where I could easily get out of there with a little tap out or tell the referee, hey, Mr. Referee, I've had enough fun for tonight. Time for me to get out of here. But law enforcement, military, and things of nature, they don't have that choice. Their tap out could mean lights out forever. So I take that with a great deal of pride, but then also what I'm showing that I'm going to give you the best I possibly can. The bad part is, I tell them this afterwards, you guys should be taking a creative writing class because you have to be able to articulate your actions afterwards, especially when it comes to something like law enforcement that's known as the use of force continuum. If you do this, I'm only able to ratchet up by 1 degree, but you're not a robot. You're a human being, and you have human emotions. And if someone just tried to kill you, and you might have been a little overzealous, and you're trying to put them on down, well, then they throw this either police brutality or something like this. I go, if you were to take other people, put them in that same role, they would never call it that in the first place. You just saved your bacon to be at least able to tell your story. I do a lot of different types of things, but I also work with the local high school where I live. I work with long jumpers, high jumpers, shot put, and throwers, and discus throwers, because, again, the understanding of mechanics, high and low hurdles. Might be hard to believe that there's big goons right here, but I used to run the hurdles as well. And for a big guy, people were kind of surprised at my agility.
Once again, Dan, for our listeners, if they're interested in contacting you about making an appearance, how would you like them to contact you?
The very best way is simply just going to the website, dansevern.com, dansevern.com. All my social media is there, and just ways of getting in touch with me are there. And it also shows even more stuff that I do that you may not be aware of. I just haven't quite figured out what I want to be when I grow up. That's all.
Dan Severn, once again, thank you for your time.
Joseph, it's been a pleasure.
This has been an interview with UFC Hall of Fame inductee Dan the Beast Severn. Check us out at www.mawradio.com and click on the Martial Arts World Radio store where you will find our t-shirt and hoodie with the Bruce Lee quote from the film Enter the Dragon, Bored Not Hit Back. Both the shirt and hoodie are black with the Martial Arts World Radio logo in red on the sleeve and the back of the shirt. They can be purchased securely directly from our site. Be sure to join us next episode for interviews with guests UFC and Bellator legendary fighter Shawnee Carter, martial artist and cinema star Keri Hiroyuki Tagawa, and the martial arts woman Andrea Harkins. We invite you to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and YouTube by following Martial Arts World Radio. I'm Joseph Clark. Thank you for joining us.